Well, we walked up from the local village. We didn't have the code to the gate. Guy was gonna let us in, but he said, well, I can't necessarily let you back out. So he said, ah, we'll walk. It's a beautiful, beautiful day for a walk. Things finally cleared up, and the rain has stopped, and this is Tel Gezer. Very strategic location, by the way. I've done some teachings on this before, and I've included it in my newsletter. This was a strategic location. It was one of the three places where we read in the scriptures that Solomon reinforced them. And there are these, what they call Solomonic gates that they find here in Megiddo and Hazor. And those are the three cities that he strengthened or reinforced. So they attribute those gates to him, three-leveled gates. This is an incredible find from this location. It's called the Gezer Calendar. Or the Gezer schedule, really. It gives a just a schedule of the crops and, you know, the routine that people would go through who lived here and who were focused on agriculture. And you can see that it's in Paleo Hebrew. And again, I've done some teachings before on this, and I encourage you to check, you know, old newsletters to look into it more. But here we see the translation: 2 months of harvest, 2 months of sowing, 2 months of late planting, 1 month of hoeing flax, 1 month of barley harvest, 1 month of harvest and measuring, 2 months of vine pruning, and 1 month of summer fruit. So, you know, we don't know exactly. It might have just been a training exercise. Some archaeologists suggested it was just somebody cycle that they had learned. So anyways, that's we don't know exactly what, but it's great for seeing how they revolved around the cycles of the harvest. And that's what we're supposed to be learning, especially through the appointed times. Now this is a great map here, because this shows where Gezer was located, on right on the edge of the Via Maris, and it's called the Way of the Sea, and the Bet Haron Road, which would go up to the Samaria, and then the Bet Shemesh Road, which would go to Jerusalem. They all connected up near Jerusalem. So a lot of trade routes here, and this was a strategic area, because it was just in the foothills of the Israelite territory. And this was actually in the tribal territory of Ephraim. And so it was a strategic city, a very well-traveled location. And it was an opportunity for the Israelites. I wrote about this before. An opportunity for them to shine as a light to the nations, as the nations were actually traveling through the land. And that's one thing we don't realize, is that this was a major trading hub. People travel through the land, the Via Maris and the King's Highway, major trade routes. The Nabataeans were very well known for trading. I've stayed over at Mamshit before, down in the south, which is a major Nabataean city, as well as Petra, which is a major Nabataean city as well. So anyways, trade was significant in this land, and that's why I think Yah chose it for Israel to shine as a light to the nations. And what a view we have from up here. It's really a beautiful location, and I highly recommend it. If you get to the land, that you come and visit this. It's not a real popular site, but there's really significant history here, and it gives you an opportunity to just see a lot of the land, even from this vantage point. So anyways, there's a lot to see here. I obviously can't do it in a short video, but I hope you enjoyed this little video, and hopefully it just kind of whetted your appetite to come and see more of the land. I actually came up to a higher vantage point, and I thought it would be nice to actually just give a better view. This is the modern community, Gezer over there. And then as we pan, that's south. And then if we pan to the west, we can see that the sun is actually, you know, starting to set. And off in the distance is the Mediterranean. And you would see Yafo and Tel Aviv. And again, Yafo was a major sea trading port as well, along with Caesarea, which was up to the north of what we see as modern day Tel Aviv, and then the Tanya and Herzliya, and eventually get up to Caesarea. So you had a lot of trade coming in this area, and again, they would come right past the city. So very important and very beautiful, really lovely up here, especially this time of year when everything is turning green. You see all this wild barley everywhere. Down there are some of the ancient ruins. This really has not been excavated to any great extent. They could do so much more, as you can see. They've got some of the highlights here that have been dug up. There's some standing stones off to in the distance, and maybe I'll get over there and take a look at those for you. Here are the remnants of a Canaanite tower. So this dates back to the Canaanite period, when this was a Canaanite city before the Israelites came in and conquered the land. And of course, one of the hallmarks of an enduring city is their water system. And this city has a deep water system that you can go down where they would draw their water from. Of course, if a city could get water from inside the gates, inside the walls, then they could withstand a siege. And that's why this was such an important city. You'll find that with many of the enduring cities that you find in the land, is that they have figured out a water system so that they can just, you know, bat down the hatches, so to speak, and withstand a siege from any enemies. And then, of course, then it comes down to food stores and the strength of your walls and your gates. Speaking of gates, these are the Solomonic gates that I referred to earlier. They were compartmentalized into three parts so that people had to, they could be defended in multiple levels. And so these are the same type of gates that are seen in, like I said, in Hatzor and Talmegiddo. And they're all three with Gezer are mentioned as places that Solomon fortified. And here they have a little informational sheet on that. One final site here to look at is the 10 standing stones, which have really been a mystery to archaeologists. They don't know exactly what is going on here with these stones. Was it something from the Canaanite period that was left, some ritualistic site? Or was it something that the inhabitants here set up as a commemoration, maybe for the Ten Commandments, maybe for the 10 tribes of Israel? We don't know exactly. But anyways, this is one of those mysteries that we continue to look into. One archaeologist thought that there was child sacrifices going on here in the Canaanite period, and you know, that cannot be confirmed necessarily. But it's interesting, and so it just shows there's so many mysteries still waiting to be solved through archaeology and our investigation into history and the scriptures.